Hey there everybody, and welcome back to the channel. My name is Chris Ormey, and today we are looking at Franchise Hockey Manager 6. Released today, as I am recording this, video will be going up tomorrow, so this 11th is when it was released. It should go up on the 12th, on the Saturday. And I've just got my hands on this and installed it. I haven't really taken a look too much at the game yet. I haven't dove into the game at all yet. But I have looked around for as much information as I can to put it up front for you guys. So, we will be taking a look at the game. But a bit of information to get through first. So, as you can see front and center, we got our system requirements. Windows 7, 8 or 10. A gig processor. 4 gig of RAM. And it's got a minimum of a 1280 by 768 display. Which has to be in full screen. 6 gig of space. The only difference with the Mac system is that it's on macOS 10.11 and it's an Intel processor chip. So it's available from their website, ootpdevelopments.onfastspring.com/FHM. It's the same price on Steam if you'd rather go to Steam to get it. Currently 10% off on a launch discount. I believe that lasts for the first week, and the first week only. So come the 19th, you're out of luck. It ends 18th of October. It's currently $35.99 in US dollars. Your regional equivalents will apply. But that is a saving of $10. You can also get the Steam key from their site, if you want to get it that way. And you can bundle Out of the Park 20 and Franchise Hockey Manager 6 together if you haven't got Out of the Park Baseball yet. That is another game that they are responsible for. Out of the Park Developments is the publisher and creator of these games. On the website, that is a total of $45.58. On Steam, slightly cheaper at the moment, $41.38. So if you're going to bundle it, I would say get it on Steam. Otherwise, it's your choice for the actual game itself, either Steam or here, but both can get through this website right here, the ootpdevelopments.onfastspring.com/FHM. So that's where to get it and whatnot, but this is an ice hockey management roster building simulation game. Take your team, make it better, put it on the ice and see how well it does. And then do it again next year. So, for those that aren't new to this channel, you would have seen some FHM. All the way back to FHM 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all the way now to 6. All the iterations have been on this channel. You'll get a good idea of what the game is. Football Manager, that is a football, or for the North Americans, the soccer sort of version of this. Out of the Park Baseball is, surprise, surprise, a baseball version of this game. Football Manager not done by Out of the Park Developments, but Out of the Park Baseball, of course, is as well. So, what's new? Let's jump into what's new. If you've been here before, you know what FHM is. Okay. So, you can lock players to a specific line for greater impact. So, if you're being a bit more hands-off, and you're being a general manager, you should now be able to lock a player to a line and stop your head coach from moving that player. If you want to give expanded game time to a recent incoming trade player, perhaps a draft pick that you've been looking to develop and want to give him more game time so he'll just become better quicker, you can now do that. Better player modeling, suspensions for on or off ice incidents, the stat-adjusted talent ratings and personality ratings evolve in response to game events. So what's that mean? It means more quality of life. It means longer saves have more personality, more fluctuations. The players aren't going to be the same year in, year out. There's going to be some growth, some regression, some development as we go. So there will be on or off ice incidents and variations of suspensions, therefore. So That's not really a good thing if you get your player suspended, but it's a nice addition to the world. Stat-adjusted talent ratings. Well, if you've got a player that's a very good player but wouldn't be classed as an elite player, maybe, and it does work on a star rating, so let's say a 3.5 star out of 5, and they have an absolutely fantastic player. Let's say you lock them to the first line. That's the line where you're most sort of likely to get goals and assists and good stat numbers and good play. You're playing with the best players. You could boost someone's sort of ratings. They get more points, which is goals and assists. I could see some of their stats go up because they're playing well to reflect that change in the player. So not just natural development, as we've been seeing, but development reacting to the game and how well they're playing. And that's more realistic. I like that one a lot. And personality ratings that involve in response to game events. So maybe people who win the cup will develop a trait of being a winner. Maybe there'll be someone who turns out to be more accident prone than they were at the start of the game, because an in-game event has them had an accident, and it turns out we discovered this about them. Personality rating, some players might get happier as they get older, some might get meaner, depending what happens in-game. So again, an evolving world you're playing in, I always think that's a good thing. So little things, but really, they could have a big impact in a long-term save, and really aid with replayability as well on top of that. New team reports. New information, always a good thing. Always a good thing. Prospect positional rankings, I love those. Team power rankings, it's always nice to see where you rank. The best and worst single game performances, a global team ranking system, and more. Nice. So if you're not managing in the NHL, which is the top layer of hockey in the world, how does your team compare? Are you as good as an NHL team? Who knows? But the game now might tell you that you're round about the same level as some other teams. Better than others, worse than others. It'll put you where you deserve to be, and that will give you an idea exactly how good this team is to somebody else that I'm familiar with. New historical challenges, they like to do that. So they've added another 25 challenges in there. So, always fun. Extend your legacy. You've got an FHM 5 save you put a lot of work into. Hey, this right down here, import FHM 5 save. You can import it into FHM 6. It'll do all the conversion for you. And bam, you're good to go. I think you need to copy the file from the folders for FHM 5. To the FHM 6 folders. But once it's there, you'll be able to import it. Not too many games of this nature do that from iteration to iteration, allow you to carry on your team. So if you have invested a lot of time, hey, you can now take it to 6. And new leagues, German, Swiss, UK second divisions, and the Spengler Cup. The Spengler Cup is an invitational tournament. It's held every year, I believe, from December 26th through the end of the month. It'll be some regular sides, some like club sides, and it can be some national sides. So like Team Canada's been in there and so on. It was in the early 1920s, I believe. It was founded, it's based in Switzerland, and really it's a pretty European-centric, sort of Eurocentric competition. But now and again, there have usually been a Team Canada, but in recent years, I believe the Rochester Americans from the AHL were invited. Some point in the last decade, I want to say 2012, maybe I'm off that. Could be somewhere on there. But basically, it's a nice tournament that wasn't represented in the game, so another quality of life addition there. Now, when you fire up FM6 now, it comes up this little window. I believe it would for other FHM games as well, so we'll dismiss that. And yeah, if you've played FHM 5, this looks really, really similar. One or two different additions, okay, that's fine. But by and large, familiar is good. Familiar is good. Let's jump in here then and see a bit more about the new feature. So the rivalry system. So rival matches have an extra significance and change over time in response to in-game results. So you can see here for the New York Rangers, their main rival is the Philadelphia Flyers. But a potential new rival in the New Jersey Devil awaits. So let's say they face each other in the playoffs a lot, or if they're in a similar division, if they're in the same division, they're sort of playing each other and battling for the same kind of wildcard spots, or to win the division, or to win the President's Trophy for the best overall record. There's a lot of different ways that that could, you know, turn into a rivalry. And then you can see here, the fans matter. Support and happiness is tracked, changing in response to in-game events, actions, affecting the team chemistry, attendance, job security, owner satisfaction, and more. So now you can see there are some changes here. So now the fans, you've got to keep them happy. They do basically pay everybody's wages. If the fans don't show up, you're not going to make money. If they don't buy merchandise, they're not going to really earn you any money. So you can see here, for wins and losses, there's a plus one. And we also see here, a plus five. A very talented player, Dave Christian, joining the Canucks, and that's boosted them up to a 69. A couple more wins, and then some losses. And now you can see, down to 67. So, just a nice little touch and a reminder that not only do you keep your owner happy, but if you can keep the fans happy and the players happy and your staff happy, it's a lot of juggling to get on with. But when everybody's on the same page, you're going to have success. Another thing you can now do is alter the history of the game. That means in historical leagues, you can change it. You don't have to abide with what happened in the past. You can restructure the league. You can add and remove teams. You can do what you want to get the league looking how you want it at any point in its history. The historical portion of the game has now got a whole lot more customizable. So you can set up historical challenges for yourself, for others. Add a team in that you thought would have been a great fit. Take out a team that you didn't think was there. You want to see what a league with the Nordiques and the Avalanche in 96 would have looked. Maybe the Nordiques don't lose their franchise to make way for the Avalanche. Maybe the Avalanche are just added as an expansion instead of a relocation. You can do that. You can see how that plays out. So, it's kind of fun. I always like when there's more customization, more tools to play with, play your way. That is never a bad thing in my book. I do like this one. With that being said, there's also the new exhibition mode where you can pit any two teams from any era against each other. And as it says, infinite possibilities from matchups. I love that. I love that. That is so cool. You want to know how one of the best teams ever faces up against, you know, one of the best teams today? How about pitting the Stanley Cup champions, the St. Louis Blues? How about putting them up against Gretzky's team? How about putting them up against his Kings or his, you know, his other teams. Like, what about an old Red Wings team with Datsyuk and Zetterberg and co? There's some interesting matchups. I can see me getting a lot of fun with this. It's not really like game-breaking, but a lovely feature. Again, not a big one here, but drop the puck with accurate 2019 opening night rosters, teams, and leagues. We know it's in there, it's the update, but it's always nice that it's opening night rosters. So everything up to opening night is now in the game. Anything after that, you're going to have to wait for a patch and an update and so on. But right now, they are where they are. Yeah, and again, more team reports, more information, really gives you an idea of what's going on and how you can set things up. So right now, what we're looking for here at the moment would be the player rankings by position. So the best center is listed as Connor McDavid, then McKinnon, Crosby, Barkov, Taves, Couturier, Ryan O'Reilly, Austin Matthews, Kopitar, and Eichel. The best overall, Pekka Rinne, is rated as the third best player in the league. Number one goalie. Vasilevsky's in there as well. And it's nice to see that there are other positions, not just centers, but it is heavily centers. They are usually the stars and captains of some big teams. And Kucherov's up there as well, reflecting what a great season he had last year and what offensive potential he does have in that Tampa Bay lineup. But, yeah, you get to see a lot of that. And you also get to see as well which are the up-and-comers. So you look here at the top of the list. McDavid, 22. McKinnon, 24. They're going to be around for a while. Barkov, Vasilevsky, Kucherov's only 26. So maybe Pekka Rinne, Sidney, maybe they drop off. You know, they're in their 30s now. They'll tail off. You know, Taves might not rise anymore. You might see a few of these bottom end guys fall off. But it's nice to know kind of who are the guys that are there right now overall and in each position. And then also, who's up and coming? Who's up and coming? So yeah, Kucherov number one, Ovechkin two, Marchand three, Taylor Hall four. They might all start to fall down. Dreisaitl's at number five, but I see him more as a center personally, but they've got him as a left winger here. And then Goodrow, Landeskog, they should hold or maybe rise when Ovechkin and Marchand fall off a little bit. Riley Smith, who knows what he's going to do. And then there might be some young left wingers. And you can also see as well the depth at the top level. So we're already, you know, at number six, we're 3.5 stars. We only get to 4 stars in center when we get down to 9th place. There's only 2 really top-notch left wings. So it's going to be nice to see that kind of thing. More information, always a good thing. Able to plan, able to maneuver. You're able to set things up in a proper fashion. And you kind of, you know, need that information because the game doesn't always give you enough to deal with a lot of the events going on and some of the roster decisions you're making. A lot of times in the past, I felt it's been kind of based on my mood. If I don't like a certain player or I don't like the way a line looks or feel, I might go change it. This gives me more information as to maybe why I can reinforce that decision. And yes, I need to replace this player because my top line, let's say I'm Colorado, I've got Landeskog on the left wing. I've got McKinnon on the right, in the center. On the right wing, I've got Rantanen, and he will appear somewhere probably on the top 10 right wingers. If not, I think the game might have that wrong. Similar as well for teams like Boston. Boston have got a great first line, but it doesn't look like they've got a top 10 center. Not with Marchand here out on the left. So maybe that's something they'll try and trade for. Maybe a Sean Couturier, 27. That might be a fit. Maybe Kopitar, if the Kings can't afford him. Now you're starting to plan and see how to structure your lines a little bit just from this one little screenshot. So you can see it's the only official licensed game by the NHL for the PC. That means all the right logos, team names, uniforms, everything is spot on, including all the histories. They, you know, they have everything in there. So you don't need to mod the game day one. We've got the updated rosters, as you can see here. We've got all the official stuff in. It's good to play out of the box. Rivalry defined. Again, back to that. So rivalries appear, grow, decline, and disappear. Fans matter. We had a look at that. Really good. The historical staff now are added because we didn't have the full historical staff, but more research had been done, added to the game. So now when you go and play in the past, you get the right staff as well as players. The exhibition mode, I said, you know, that's pretty cool. And yeah, the most detailed hockey game now has even more details. The most impressive NHL game and ice hockey game is now even more impressive. I love that. I love that. And while some of these features won't affect the way I play the game, they're still really, really good features. So yeah, we can look here now at historical challenges. So some of these here, for the Flames, Bruins, etc. Got some of the old teams. The Rockies are in there. The Whalers, the North Stars. Quebec. So, all these are the old teams. Sort of the more historical teams at times, I think. And then we've got some modern day teams as well mixed in. Then we've got a few more back down here as well. Extra ones that don't seem to have logos, but some of the teams back then, when they were looking, you know, back to the early 1920s, there's a reason why not. Well, that's kind of cool. Again, you've got Steamworks. You can load in all the different bits from the Steam Workshop. So that might be custom leagues or players or drafts or new logos, historical logos, alternate stuff like uniforms. All that will be up there. The custom game settings are pretty much the same as well. We go on as we did before. Quick start. Again, we can save, you know, set up a save the way we wanted and put it in as a quick start. So you can keep loading that same world over and over and play within it. And the historical game, again, goes all the way back to 1917. All the way through every year, up to the last year. You've got all these different bits and pieces. Like the level of depth is outstanding, I've got to say. The level of depth is outstanding. There's also a link to the manual for anything you don't understand in here. The forums, the webpage, they'll get you a lot of help on what you need to expand upon the game experience as well. Import your save, as we said. And you can see it's a part of the NHL family with the sponsorship and the license that they do have. And now as well, who they work with, Elite Prospects, etc. So there is quite a lot. Any extra rosters and databases will be listed down here if you download them or if they are updated along with the game. We're currently playing version 6.1, build 41. And you can have an online game or a single player game. If you don't know, they did bring in online into the game. I hope it works a little better than it has done in previous version, but it's something I would like to do. I would like to do like a season or two seasons of maybe an international tournament and get an online league up. So we're just going to name this review and set it up. I'll be back when it's up and running, telling how long it actually took. Okay, so about a minute and a half. Set up the leagues as well, just chose North America, basically. So all of Canada and the NHL. Didn't look at the AHL, etc. for that. Set ourselves up, again, lots of cities to choose from. So I can get my actual details in the game, which, while not a big thing, it does mean something cool to me. And then general manager or head coach, or just general manager, it depends. I like to play as a GM and hire a head coach to actually play the games and manage the team. I like setting up the team. The difference between it is I won't be in charge of tactics or choosing the lines or anything like that. My job is to assemble the team. So I'll be doing drafting, trading, recruitment, contracts, all that kind of side of the business. As usual, to start things off, though, we'll be looking at my favorite team, the Avalanche. And yeah, that's about it. You can set up your preferences in different ways for how you want your teams to work and how you want to be. There's a bunch of things I like to do, but basically I don't care if I get sacked. But I'm supposed to be good at assembling a team, so negotiations need to be high. Self-preservation, I should have put down at zero. So there we go. In fact, I'll probably do the player management up. No. Again, that's head coach duty, not really general manager. So there we go. And then this stuff really doesn't matter. Really doesn't matter. There we go. We're just going to set up. Yeah, we're just going to set up that way. And then again, we're back to this as it actually builds the world now. So again, we'll dive off and come back when it's set up, and I'll let you know roughly how much time this took for me. And okay, we are back about 3 and a half minutes in. So possibly a grand total of around about 5 minutes total. So that's not bad, really, to set up a game from, you know, from the main menu to getting into the game. I'm pretty happy with that. I am pretty happy with that. So yeah, first glance around, everything looks pretty much as it did in FM5. Everything's laid out the same. It all seems very well laid out again. Easy to read, information's where you expect it to be. We've got all these tooltips. Some of them not showing on screen because we're not in full screen mode. So it's hanging outside the recording window as well. But we've got the National Hockey League standings. Then we've got a schedule, the transactions, stats, events, the history, and the scouting. So that's league-wide stuff there. And then your team-centric stuff is up here, including your roster, your strategy, the depth chart, your team schedule, the personnel, which is the non-playing staff, the history. You've got the unsigned draftees. I couldn't think what that was there for a second. Upcoming free agents, people will be leaving your team at the end of the season unless you re-sign them to a new deal. And transaction log, where all the basically ins and outs of your team, promotions, demotions, trades, drafts, etc., retirements, where all that comes to rest on one screen for easier viewing. Okay, so whenever I take over, I look at a few things, but first will be the news. So welcome to the Avalanche family. We've got a contract, 2-year term, $2.14 million a year. And the owner does want playoffs. So, yeah. In FHM 5, that was a much lower objective because we weren't that good a team. You know, we weren't a good team a couple of years ago. So, last year, not a lot was expected of us. This year, it's a playoff race. And now we're going to have to really work. You can see our payroll and the amount of money we've got to work with. You still deal with the league cap, but this is how much the team are giving you to work with. Even if it's under the cap or over the cap, you're going to have to figure out the way to pay everybody with this figure, as well as abide by the league terms. And yeah, look at your roster, depth chart, personnel, get familiar. And that's my next step. Oh, nearly my next step. But you can see here the deadline on the 24th of February. The salary cap is 81.5. The floor is 60.2. We're on the high end of that. We are on the high end of that because that will be Rantanen's deal, basically. So yeah. He signed that. And now you can see Lafreniere is going to be the top prospect. Byfield, Raymond Holtz, Lundell, Askarov, top goalie. And these stats here, the ability and potential, if you haven't played previously, they'll range from 1 to 5. Or 0.5, I should say, to 5. As we can see in Byfield. If I can actually click on him properly. So we can see here, he's a 0.5 to 5-star player. But we don't know much about him. That's what the world thinks he is, but that may or may not be accurate. You can see here the letter afterwards. That goes from E, which is pretty much unknown, all the way up to A, which is where your scouts think we've got a good grasp of what this boy is and what he can do. So, there is that. And then you can see all the player information here, all the personal stuff, what team he's currently on, if he's related to anyone, some popularity stuff, etc. And then the contract, what he's done in the season, and then a bit about how happy he is currently with the team, any pluses or minus in terms of what's affecting his happiness right now. Injury status, any sort of knocks and niggles will show up here, as well as big injuries. And you can see here, he's probably between normal and durable. That's why we've got this this slanted line of durable through normal. So there's no one area of weakness. Some players will have like a red head, showing that they pick up head injuries quite often. Maybe legs or whatever. It all depends on the different players. And it is a location-based injury tendency. So that is good. And then positional ratings, which positions he plays. Again, this is out of 20. So you can see he is a center. He can play left wing. He can play right wing, but it will take him some time to train those up and get used to playing in those positions. His defensive position's not that great, but left defense would be his position in defense. And he has no idea how to play as a goalie. You look at the ratings, and again, everything sort of is similar again to FHM5. Again, we got these positions here to help you out. And yeah, you can see here, a key skill is green, so getting open as a perimeter shooter. That's currently a 14. The red are other key skills. And then each of these categories is how good he is in a certain area, but they all contribute in different ways to these roles. So you can now see as well what kind of a player he is, what he's good at, individual strengths and weaknesses, what you might want to train. If you're looking for a center to come in and be a main guy and win face-offs, you're going to need a good face-off skill, of course. You want a defensive player? Hey, it's you. You want a physical enforcer-type players? Hey, Byfield could be your guy. He's a physical, probably a goal scoring because he's got high offensive ratings. Not great passing out of everything. But he's got a pretty good shot, pretty good offensive read, which just means how well he reads offensive situations and plays. So when he's on offense, he knows pretty much what's going on. Defensively, he's not too sure going back for the puck where he should be or what's likely to happen in any given situation. But he can analyze the play on offense. So if you want that kind of guy who's physical, good offensively, can take face-offs, and, you know, hasn't really got a mental weakness. He's not an aggressive guy, but, you know, he really sort of holds himself together well. Does the dirty work in front of the net, screening the goalie. Great balance and strength. Great face-offs. Byfield could be the guy you go after in the draft. So I like that, the amount of information you get. But until it's fully scouted, you never know quite what this is going to turn out to be. So let's look then at the Avalanche. And unlike other games in this kind of genre of sports management, you're not always looking for five stars everywhere. There are four lines. Your primary line is line one. That will be your goal scoring, sort of offensive, all action, superstar line. Line two is a secondary scoring line usually. Line three can be either a checking line, which means defensively solid and physically punishing, which is technically what a lot of the fourth lines are. But you can also have some more goal scoring from the third. It really depends which way you want to set your team up. So what you're looking for is in each of these positions, goal, left defense, right defense, left wing, right wing, and center, one good player. So we can see Landeskog. We know he's one of the top left wingers in the league. We saw that on that little diagram that we looked at early in the video, the top 10 for the positions. He was, what, number 7, I believe? So he's there. 3.5 star now. He can rise to a 4 star. 26. He is the captain. That's what the C is for. The A is assistant. So he's a very good left winger. On the right, Rantanen. 4 star, 4.5 potential. Very young Finnish player. Great little player. He'll fill on that first line right wing. And Nathan MacKinnon, the second best player in the league. Second best center, both behind McDavid. What a great player MacKinnon is. So he is one of the stars of this league. You look at the back end, and like these three defenders, Eric Johnson is solid, but he's not developing. He's 31. Big contract, $6 million. Really, there's only two players paid more. One is MacKinnon, which is a cheap deal for MacKinnon because he signed it years ago. He's still got a long time to go, another 4 years on that deal. And Rantanen's just got paid at 9.25 for the next 6. So, Johnson's not great. Cale Makar, 20 years of age, only slightly worse right now. 4.5 star potential. That's what we're looking for. Sam Girard, 2-star to 3.5-star, that's my first line. If I'm taking over this team, I'm probably looking to trade Johnson and try and get something back. Shift that contract, gain the cap room so I can use that on another player, and then start shipping out some of these depth players, the older players. Ian Cole, Barbario, not a big fan. So I can get rid of those. But you can see if we get another young right defenseman, we're pretty good, and we have got those in the organization. Left defense, it's Girard. Zadorov's good for a third pairing, because you've got three pairings of defensemen. You've got four lines of a left wing, right wing, and center. And then you've got three pairings, which go and switch which line they play with, depending on the situation, of defensemen. So a total of 12 forwards and 6 attackers. So really, I think right now, if we got rid of Johnson and we got a cheaper veteran that was 2-star, 2-star, I'd be happy there with Timmins and Makar rather than pay Johnson that much money. We do lose one of our leaders and a popular player, and there will be downsides to that. But really, that would be my move. And then on this side, Girard and Zadorov, I'd probably look for a 2.5 to 3-star player, maybe a bit older, maybe a veteran, someone to come in and replace what Johnson does, but on a better contract. Grubauer thinks that's harshly rated. He's a very, very good goaltender who's unproven at some level, but had a very good year last year. So I think that's a bit of a harsh rating right there. Probably harsh on Graves there. The rest of the team seems to be okay, honestly. The rest of the team seems to be okay. But yeah, we got some new players in, so a bit of rebuilding work. I'd probably want a better second line left winger. Although we'll run with Jost because he's got the potential. That would work. And then we've got Kadri. And we've got Donskoy. So yeah, the depth is pretty good. Yeah, the depth's pretty good. Defense probably needs working on. In real life, I'm very happy we have Grubauer. But again, in game, I'd probably trade him away. So maybe I even package up Grubauer and Johnson together to get a good goaltender. And then that frees up a lot of money to go and sign a decent right defenseman. Maybe give up something else for it. But it's a good look at what you've got age-wise, nationalities, etc. just on the page. And we know a lot about these players. So the league says Cale Makar is a 1.5-star player. Our team says he's a 2-star player. We know him better than the league. He's our player. So we think that he's better than the league thinks he is. But we don't think he's got as much potential as the league thinks he has. So that's interesting. That is interesting. If the league rated him at, say, 2 stars and 5 stars, and then we rated him as 1.5, 4.5, then we know he's not as good as other people think he is. And now I'm starting to think to myself, I should cash in while I can. While other people rate him higher than we do, we can probably trade him for someone similar, that we think is similar, another 2-star, 5-star player, when in reality we're giving up 1.5, 4.5. So we're giving up less to get, you know, to get similar or more back in return than what we actually think he is. But that being said, we do not trade Cale Makar. We do not trade Cale Makar. Physically, really good. Offensively, really good. Defensively, fairly solid. Mentally, really good. You can see here his best role on the team will be as a point shooter. And that means a defenseman back towards the corner of the ice, taking shots from range. And if a player's got good screening to get in front of the net and make a nuisance of themselves, they can redeflect the puck into the back of the net. We can see here now the scouting, pretty middle-of-the-road guy. So, just a normal guy. He's not a number one in the league. He's definitely a top three. And yeah, I'd probably play him as number two. So, on that top pairing with Sam Girard, who'd probably get a worse current role report. And there's a comparison as well with Erik Karlsson, one of the league's best offensive-minded defensemen in the entire league. So, that's always a good thing. That's always a good thing. He's playmaking. He works hard. He's got good stamina, and he's a good skater. He's not very physical play, but even the worst aspects are relatively strong. So again, you're now getting more of a feel for the player. He's approximately equal in terms of value with Sam Girard. Again, that is someone that we like a lot as well. Solid player. He's probably going to be much better than Sam Girard is right now. Top player in the league in the future. We quickly jump to Sam Girard. It keeps us on the scouting tab, and we see he's more like Matt Dumba, which isn't as good, but pretty decent. Solid number two, number three. Playmaking, good student, wants to learn, decent stamina, above average skater. He's fairly clean, so he doesn't give away too many penalties. Again, lacks a little bit of physicality. He's very young, and he's an offensive-minded, not defensive-minded, so we do expect that. He's more closely compared to Erik Johnsson, the old veteran we would be looking to trade away. Solid, top player. So, again, if we look at Johnsson, we know he's getting on a little bit. We know he's declining. He's a bit like Chara, which is an excellent defenseman. Excellent defenseman. His intangibles, the stuff you can't measure. His hockey senses, his knowledge, his experience, that's what Johnson brings to the team. He won't tire out. He'll keep playing all day long, very strong and skating, but he does get injured a lot, which is another reason why I'd look to replace him. And he is currently injured. So there is that. There is that. But looking at the team, like I say, Johnson going out would be something I would look at. 1 to 2 months left with a shoulder impingement. But Sam Girard, Cale Makar, very, very solid players. And UEC Sam Girard is probably fairly scouted by the league. We both have him in the team and in the league at a 2-star ability with 3.5-star potential. So plenty of room to grow for a young man, but he won't be a superstar defenseman. Cale Makar could be. And again, you see very similar. Solid mentals, probably not quite as good as Makar. Solid physicals, similar to Makar, similar defenses, not quite as good offenses. So that's why we like Makar that little bit more. But he can be a rushing defenseman. You can see there using his pace, trying to get that puck down ice, and then just being offensive when he gets there. Great offensive read at a 17. Great puck handling, which means skating with the puck. But he can also play two-way and be a bit more defensive. He can also be very mobile and just be all over the ice if you need him to. He's decent as a quarterback. He's decent as a point shooter. They're only slightly below as well. Yeah, we like that. And then we got a breakdown of the contract, all the details you want, where they were drafted, in which organization, which league, what year, the round and number overall they went, to what team. We got seasonal stats here, so you can break down between home and away and see all kinds of stuff. You can hover over these normally to show you what exactly they are. Game by game stats. His career stats, you can see what he's done in the NHL. 3 points in 5 games, that's pretty good for Nashville. Then he came to Colorado, 20-68, decent first season. And then 27-82, kind of held the same. For a young defender, those are pretty decent numbers. And like I say, we're not expecting him to be the biggest, best guy in the world. But he's definitely got a future. So let's say we're looking here at the contracts. As well as those players we've just seen, there's going to be a few other players as well who aren't yet at the club. And they're usually the ones with zero salary. So we can look and see that Bowen Byram is a very good young player. Not quite ready yet, but to be honest with you, at age 18, he's pretty much as good as the other players in the position. So I would probably call him up and play him. In real life, we're not going to for various reasons, but he was drafted just recently, 4th overall in the entire draft class. It's a good thing. And we again think he's slightly better currently than the league does, but again, we think he's slightly below where the league thinks he'll end up. So we can do whatever we want with that language. To spin it in our favor in terms of trades, etc., if we want to do that. But really, you're sitting on an 18-year-old and a 20-year-old, or a 19-year-old, I think maybe Makar is. He might have turned 20, but they're both 1.5-star current ability and 4.5-star potential. So long-term, the Avalanche look really good at the back end. And again, ratings-wise, solid, okay, pretty decent offensively, solid defensively, and he is a rushing defenseman, two-way or mobile. He's really very, very similar, just probably better long-term than Sam Girard. But that will be the top three. You know, Makar, Byram, Girard, that could be the top three for the next, I don't know, 10, 15 years. That's impressive. They won't be too bad of a weakness right now. In 1 to 2 years, they'll be ready to be starters and really handle the workload we'll be giving them. And long term, they'll be damn fine players. And again, here you see, he does play similar to Gerrard. He's normal. Again, Dumba. He doesn't score goals. So he's more of a defensive player, getting some assists. But again, that fits him with the other players we've got because they can score goals. None of them are a serious liability. He's a great skater. And he's solid on most teams in our league. So even though he's only 1.5 star, he is not a weakness right now. And again, that's the third young defenseman we have that could be a top player in the league. So why not call him up? He's a left defenseman. Remember, 1.5, 3.5? Well, Ryan Graves is 1 to 1.5. So he's better than Graves. He's similar right now to Cole and Barbario, the two veterans, but he'd be much better in the future. And Zadorov. He's very similar to Zadorov in terms of current ability, but again, he has that potential. So when we look at it that side of things, again, why not call him up? Makar, Gerrard, and him. Zadorov, that gives us our three left-sided defensemen. That gives us Kyle Makar. We can keep Connor Timmins in for depth. We can keep Graves in for depth. We can trade Cole Barbario and Johnson. Pick up another defenseman to play defensively on the right-hand side. A cheaper veteran who's just solid again. And I think we'd be okay at the back. So, and that's just looking at him. Shane Bowers, if you want a center. If you want more depth, we've got a young guy. That means we can trade a veteran. On the right-hand side, not ready yet, but Martin Kaut will come good. Henry, more of a role player, only 3-star potential, but again, for depth, he could be good. If we want a backup goalkeeper, we might not get Werner up. It's a little bit worse than he should be. Just a little bit. A little bit more depth would be nice on the back end. Ty Lewis could be depth. Dickinson could be depth. Seeing as Belmar's there, 1.5, 1.5. Dickinson, much younger, and he's 1 to 2 stars. So, again, if you want to make these kind of moves, you can. But you can see these are the players that you haven't got at your team right now, but they are signed, and that means they can play for you. Again, AJ Greer, quite young. He will fill a role that somebody paid much more will do. Dries is another one. Tynan can be another one. Megna can be another one to call up cheaply. So we've got some options. Not a ton of depth. Then we got the protected list. So these are the players that if they sign for other people, we get compensation. And again, we can sort this by potential. We should be able to sort this as well by potential, just so you can see where we're at. And then we can look at the cap hit. So now you're looking and saying, yes, Kaut, Byram, Bowers, Henry, Lewis. They're not in the first team, but they could all be good first team players for us. Maybe not right away, a couple of them be decent sort of depth pieces. They probably all need a year or so to develop, but it's where we can put them. The injury list, we've got a couple of those right now. Waivers, if we're trying to get rid of people, you have to release them to waivers, which means another club can take them for free before you can put them in your lower league team. The trading block, if you put players here, it tells other teams that you're willing to let them go and to send you offers for those players. And a shortlist, just the shortlist you have. Lines, if you are the head coach, you can start dragging and dropping people in and locking them and changing how they play and what they play and where they play. So I can ask the assistant to set us up and we can see McKinnon is 20 out of 20 as a sniper. Rantanen's an 18 rated two-way forward and Landeskog counter-attacking at 14. He might be better elsewhere. But then if you click on it, you see kind of where they play, how they play that role, And also, we can tell him to be far more attacking than that role or his natural tendencies would be. Do not pass the puck. Keep it high tempo. And so on. You can do all that kind of stuff as you want to. You can set it by player. You can set it by the units. So by each line, you can modify how we're going to play in each situation. You can also see here, the first line, great offensively, very quick, got some skill. Not great defensively, not weak, but not great. And lacks a little bit of toughness. Line two currently is Nikushkin, Kadri, Donskoy. Three new players. Solid all over. Again, not that tough, but the top lines usually aren't. A little bit of offense. That's not bad. Then we've got a very balanced line. Low on skill for the third line. But Tyson Jost, JT Compher's on there. Zadorov's on there currently as well. A solid line. And then back down to the fourth line. That looks like another attack-minded line. So good offense, good skill, decent defense and speed. Again, as always, lacks a bit of toughness. So I think a lot of teams would actually have this as a fourth line. Because it's more tough, it's more well-rounded. And this being an attack-minded line would probably be up at line three. But yeah, you can also look at the special teams. If you're up a player or down a player, you get all those kind of things as well. Or if you're up or down by two players, you've got the instructions for those as well, including some tactical stuff and an explanation of what each means. Your depth chart is rated top to bottom, best to worst players. So you can see, if we did call up Bowen Byram right now, he would be number four. If we traded Eric Johnson, he would be three behind Makar, Gerard, and then him, like we said. And again, Belmez in the team, but Dries could easily come up and do that job. So what I was seeing and what I was looking at, we can just see here. As well as your best prospects in the team, and at all levels, basically, you can see the potential. You can also see the draft picks. So when we go into a draft, what round? There's seven different rounds. So you can see where we're going to be drafting. Not only this year, but next year and the year after. As you can see, we hold a full 1 through 7 rounds in each of the next two seasons. What you might see, though, is we don't have a round two in this upcoming draft. We do have a round three, but it's Toronto's, not ours. And then we've got an extra sixth with the Panthers. So we've lost the second, gained the sixth. Not too much of a big deal. The schedule, you can see what comes up. The history of the organization. Again, these are the historical best players in each position. Joe Sakic, legendary center, captain for years, won two Stanley Cups. There's our two championships. And Patrick Roy is the best goalie to ever play for the Avalanche. And yeah, you can see season by season where we broke down and where they were even as the Nordiques, the old team. You can see they were a playoff team. They weren't a champion. First season they moved to Colorado. They won it in 96 with Sakic being the club captain and Patrick Roy in net. And then he did it again 5 years later in 2001 before starting to drift off, missing the playoffs, not being a good team. And then suddenly you can see one of the worst in the league in 2017. 2018, they were back. Last year, they played really well. Overall, it's moving in the right direction. And you can see all different kind of stuff in here. Nothing new, but they're all fun little bits to look at. The info. So this is the home page for the team. You can see where we rank in the league. When we play some games, that will fill out. The team data. We retired the following numbers. League-wide is number 99 for Wayne Gretzky, the greatest player ever to play. And then Ray Bourque. He wasn't really our player for long, but he did come in and win the cup with us. He played his whole career without winning one, came to Colorado, and we got him the cup finally. So that was a big story. Market size, kind of how much money and how much fan interest and all that is in your local area. So Denver is a big market for ice hockey. There are other bigger markets, of course, like New York and LA. They are always big markets for any sports because the amount of people and the amount of money that's in LA and New York. But Colorado's pretty decent, and the fan loyalty, normal. If we win, they'll show up. If we don't, they're not going to. Now, Minnesota as a potential rival, I agree with. I'd probably put them in as a rival right now. And New Jersey, I would put in as a potential rival for right now. Twice, we were going to get the number one overall pick, but the draft lottery, which stops people from just having a bad season to get the best up-and-coming young player. So they do a lottery to randomize the draw order. And twice when Colorado was scheduled to pick number one overall, New Jersey won the lottery and took that number one pick off us. Yeah. That sucks. Plus, we beat them for our second cup in 2001. They've got a couple of our former players. And season before last, when McKinnon had a great season, their captain, Taylor Hall, had a similarly good season, but was adjudicated to be the best player in the league just ahead of McKinnon. So he took the Hart Trophy. And I don't think that's right. I think the McKinnon was better and continued to be better after that year. So for me, Devils are up there. Historically, the Red Wings, the team of the early 2000s, late 90s, when the Avalanche were at their peak and starting to cool down, great rivalry with the Detroit Red Wings as well. So, wild for certain, but I would put the Devils and Red Wings in there as well. Team chemistry, everyone's pretty happy right now. Then you can see what's here. Kamenev is selfish. We don't like that. We don't like that. Burakovsky, a bit of a prankster. Probably not an issue. Helps keep morale up. But yeah, these are pretty much the bad ones. These are pretty much the positive ones. So Burakovsky keeps the mood lightened. Spark Plug, those are the energy guys. They're the ones that get everyone else going. We have a bunch of those. The leaders, Comfort, McKinnon, our best player, and club captain is Landeskog, as you see there. Our job security, we can see the fans are fairly happy to begin with. Our job security is high. We want to get into the playoffs. The team chemistry is okay right now. Few new players we need to grow. We can see a bit about the owner and whatnot as well. Not the most patient of people is Stan Kroenke. So if we don't get this right, we could be out. And now we're back to the news tab where we started off. This is where it sits in the menus. And yeah. It's just a nice little touch. Any information will come through here. So we look at the transactions. Upcoming free agents. All these players need a new contract. But really, when you look at it, Kamenev's 23. He should get a new deal. But remember, he's selfish. So with 1 year left, I'm probably going to try and trade him and let someone else deal with him in the future. Try and get something back before we lose him for free. Burakovsky will try and re-sign. 24 is a good age. Pretty decent player right now. Will get a little bit better. But my main issue is getting Tyson Jost signed up. He could be a good, good player. So that would be my main one. Everyone else, I'm not fussed. They're depth. They're replaceable. It's whatever. There's no really young players here with any potential. You know, Zadorov, two-star player, 24. Greer at 22. Nikushkin at 24. I'll try and get those on like cheap deals if I can. 1.5 stars are easily replaceable, so I wouldn't bother. And then Burakovsky, yes. Kamenev, no, because he's selfish. Jost is the big one. The unsigned draftees. These are players that are not under contract, but that we do own the rights to. So we do need to get a contract, but these are players we have drafted in the past, and we've got a certain time period after the draft to sign them. And then normally I just go straight into the info, sort by position, I know I can see. Kvachka could be a good goalie. Anunen could be a good goalie. So that goalie backup issue we might have had, it's fine. They're going to take time to develop, but they're there. That defensive depth that we're looking for long-term, Lieberman will be 2-star. Zuralayev will be 2. Harrison will be 3-star. In the wing department, on the left, Weiss, Morrison, solid players. Bit more backup, Samperanta and Smirnov. On the right, Bocage will be decent. Kovalenko, Mutala, solid backups. And then Newhook could be as good as a second-line center. Steinberg would be a decent third-line center. And then fourth-liners and depth for Saigon and Burzan. So it's not a bad place to be, but I can already see at age 21, Klerman, it's time to trade. Boykov, 23, time to trade. We look up here, Miner and Shmakov. We've already got a couple of good goalie prospects. It's time to let those boys go as well. So we're already looking at the trading assets we have and what we can do. You can see that we've put Eric Johnson and Ian Cole on injured reserve. And we've called up Jacob McDonald through there. And these are the free transfers. These are the players that are unattached to any club. If we sort by potential, it'll take a while, but you can see. Francis, we could pick up. He could be decent. We need a bit more on the wing. Boyle, solid, 34, but we could do with him for a year or two to hold down that position. Patrick Marlowe's 40. Probably not going to go for him. Honka, solid. So yeah, a little bit of potential. And then we got the two stars to fill out the roster. So all those players that were coming up to the end of their deal and they weren't two-star potential, they're 1.5 and below, I can get those. I don't need to do anything crazy. So that's why I was saying I can get rid of them. The summary is the value gained chart here. So each player that goes in and out will get a value. Net profit or minus loss will be in there. As you can see, nobody's done any deal. The trade screen, if I really wanted to get rid of Eric Johnson, I right-click on him and add, he's got a no-trade clause. That means there's a list of teams that he will not go to. But we can, if we want to, cycle through and see who he will go to. Boston. Now, Boston's going to be up at the top of the payroll. Remember, it's $80 million for the year, which means we've probably got to take back $4 million in payroll, in contract. But it does have a big budget, so that wouldn't be an issue. But now we've selected Boston here, we can go in and look at Boston Bruins. And now we can start planning of who we might want to take. Tory Krug, 1 year. He'd be solid. McAvoy, I mean, that's a big player for the future. We really probably don't want to be doing that deal. He's a little bit fragile on his legs. Head could take a little bit of a hit. His body's fairly durable. We haven't fully scouted him, but we do believe he's better than the league thinks he is as well. But as you can see, a really defensive player. So for me, I'd really like to add someone like a Charlie McAvoy in here, but it's hardly very likely they will accept. So now we go down into the rights. Who can we afford to lose? Well, we were talking about Smirnov. Zuralayev. And Trent Miner. Now, we can only put five things in the deal, so I've left one spot open. Because now we can go and trade a draft pick and see, okay, that third is not going to cut it. Yeah, even the first won't cut it with that deal. So if we wanted to give up our first rounder and our third rounder, plus Eric Johnson, to get a better contract on a better player that's going to get better and will fit exactly what we want, we need to pay for it. We do need to pay for it. So I can't give up the 7th. Or the 6th. What about the 5th? Yeah, no, it's going to take a little bit. I would like that 3rd if possible. So the other option we do have is looking here and saying, okay, who might they want in return? So if they're losing a defender, maybe they want a defender back. Maybe an Anderson. No. Pretty sure they... Well, they actually might want those because we just got worse without them. Let's add in a 5th. And... the rights to Smirnov again. Yeah, it's going to take a lot for that deal to go through, but we can work it in a way that makes sense to us. Of course, maybe Boston's not the team to deal with. So now we're just going to keep going here. In fact, we can sort by age because... he's like one of the oldest. And then try and find another team. So Calgary, okay. Calgary would be okay. But who do we bring back? Valimaki would be nice. Again, attack-minded, but he'd be nice. Noah Hanfin, again, would be good, but more offensive. He might fit, though. He might fit. He might fit. Anderson, 2... to 2.5 star. Cheap deal. Young player. Solid. Fits what we like. Is a fairly defensive player. Not weak elsewhere. You know what? That could be a cheap player to throw in. Rasmus Anderson. But they don't want to do that. Okay, if they don't want to do that, what have they got? Not a lot. Yeah. If we throw in our 1st... and then we throw in Grubauer. They can't add that much salary. Let's see if we can take a salary dump back. On a pretty poor player. It's only got 1 year left. I mean, Brody doesn't want to join us. Frolik is on the trade block. So for 1 year, if we can swallow that contract, that wouldn't be too bad. Yeah, we could maybe bring in Rittich, but that wouldn't be an upgrade. Frolik says no. Harmonic. Okay, anybody else I could probably bring in? Talbot as backup. And then we can start looking. So Cam and everyone to get rid of, so we can drop him in. Crewman, I mean, Saigon, we can probably drop in. There we go, it's well balanced. So we get a first rounder and Rasmus. We take two dumps back and we're giving up two starters. We still need to find a goalie, which would be that first rounder. It's too much. It's too rich. So we've got to find the balance somewhere. But you can see here we do have money to spend in the finances. Nice breakdown. Nothing new. I don't think there's any new on that screen as well. The staff and where to go and sign them. But we've got $1 million basically to spend if we want to on different people. Scouting, we can ask the AI to set that up. I will be going in for a proper save and doing more of that. Training, I don't deal with. I don't deal with. So the tournaments now, you can see there's all the tournaments listed here in the world. All the national teams at all the different levels, as well as all the different stuff here. In Manager, we've got options as well. As always, normally I don't like a lot of news items, so I do that. Yeah, I don't want Do Not Disturb. We have a head coach, so those are automatically assistant, but I like to set the scouting to assistant once I've chosen my scouts. Don't show games. Everything else, this is my bread and butter here. Roster moves, transactions, trades, and draft players. That's my business right there. Play the kids and don't exit unless I get a trade proposal that I might want to see. But yeah. And then here, as always, we've got all the different leagues you can choose from. All the different bits about the league, most of which is represented here on this bar. But the new ones, the prospect rankings. This will be the final thing we look at in the video. But you can see right now that the best prospect in the league is Jack Hughes, one of the two sort of players that New Jersey has drafted number one overall when the Avalanche should have been one overall but lost the lottery. As I say, there's a reason we should have a rivalry. Then Kako, Suzuki, Veleno, 48, Foodie, McLeod, Lundstrom, Kupari, Anderson, Dolan, Vesalainen, Hayton, and Zadina, and so on. If we look down here, we'll be able to see that Colorado's Martin Kaut is rated at number 23. That's pretty high for Kaut. That's pretty high for Kaut. I mean, if some of these players are set up, then I would expect, like, Cale Makar to be on this list. Is he further down, or are they just offensive players right now? Yeah, these are the forwards. Okay. So that makes a lot of sense. But Martin Kaut is 23rd on the list. You'll see teams have multiple players in Europe. LA, for example, they have Kupari and Anderson Dolan. They've got their center through Kupari. They've got their winger in Anderson Dolan. Potentially a winger. It's what I see him playing. And they're both absolutely fantastic. So the future is there for the Kings. We scroll down even more. Shane Bowers is 54 for Colorado. Scroll down even more. 75 is Newhook. Got him listed as a center. Yeah, that's good. That's what he should be. And then defenseman. Cale Makar and Bowen Byram. One and two. It's where the weakness in the team is right now, but long term is where the strength is. We get the right goalie with the young, great first line and the pretty decent depth we've got up front. If we get these boys developing, you know what? That's some team we're going to have. That is some team we're going to have. We scroll down a little bit more. Connor Timmins here is 81 overall, but pretty high up on the list of defensemen. So that's three. Sam Gerrard is not a part of this. He's too old. He's too old and he's in the NHL team already. But that gives us number four. So Connor Timmins and McCarr on the right. Byram and Gerrard on the left. Great. Spencer Knight, the only goalie being ranked. The system rankings. As you can see, Colorado is number four. Our best prospect is McCarr, then Byram, then Kout, Bowers and Newhook. The LA Kings, as we saw, Kupari and Dolland. They've also got Vilardi at 17, Thomas at 24, and Durzi at 60. Mainly centres. Mainly centres. The most important position, I would say, would be a centre and a goalie. They've got four centres there. That's pretty impressive. And that's pretty impressive. Power rankings. When the season goes, you'll see how that develops. The positional rankings, this is what we looked at a little bit. McDavid, McKinnon, etc. There we go. See Dreisaitl barely making it onto the list. In the center, McKinnon is high up. Left wing, number 10, but as good as number 6, Johnny Gaudreau on Stars. And more well-rounded than other players. Like, he's got an extra point here in defense. He's got 2 points in offense, gives up one in offense, still a plus one. He could be possibly higher than Laine. He's similar to Jonathan Huberdeau, and he's better in terms of roundness than Gaudreau. So I'd rank him number 7 there, looking at the numbers, sort of sorting by stars and then adding up the numbers and seeing overall where they are. They do seem a little bit weighted towards the offense. To a point of view where Malkin is only a 4-star, but has a higher offense than Barkov, who's a 4.5, and so is ranked above him. So these aren't sort of flat-out ratings either. But on the right wing, number 3 in the league. So Landeskog, our club captain, is number 10. McKinnon's number 2 in his position. Rantanen is number 3. Alongside Mitch Marner. Kucherov, of course, number 1. The great player he is. Defenseman Burns and Carlson. You remember we've had players compared to Erik Karlsson, mainly Cale Makar. And you can see there, San Jose Sharks, very defensive team. And they have a great pairing in defense. And then in goals, again, we lack. But if we wanted to trade for someone, maybe up here would be too much. But the Jets, 26-year-old Connor Hellebuck, he's a goalie I like a lot. He'd be my first port of call for a trade at goalie. Defenseman, I like Parayko, I think, at his age. He could be a nice pickup. Seth Jones, probably too much. So yeah, if we wanted to pick people up, we could. And then you can see overall in the teams, we're the fourth best prospect pool. So the fourth best young team. Tampa were quite high on that. If we go back and look at the systems. Yeah, they were 18th, which is just below mid-table. But they're better than a lot of teams in that system that they've got going. But they are number 1 overall. We're number 4 in terms of the team for the future. Right now, we're 15th, middle of the pack. We've got the third best forward lines. But we're 27, nearly at bottom in defense. And not much better in goal. So we can make those moves. You can see, though, we do have 5-star talent with McKinnon. And it's there with Kucherov, Matthews, Crosby. McKinnon with McDavid. Those are the main talents in the league. Injury report around the league, who's where, and the game performances as the season goes on. You see the best and the worst around the league. So those are the new stats in there. Everything else is pretty much the same. As I say, familiarity is good when it doesn't need to be changed, but they have changed a few things to make it easier to see and to update things to kind of get you playing a little bit better and make it easier to find out what's actually going on in the game. So overall, what do I think? The new features, they're good. They are good. There's a couple in there I'm really sort of happy with. There's a couple more that I'm happy with than, you know, than others. So for example, the new rankings we just looked at, I love that. I'm a big fan of that. That will help me build a team. And that's kind of my job as general manager. So that's big for me. The player modeling, where they'll gain and lose sort of abilities and personalities and all kinds of stuff on and off the ice. That just makes it a better world to play in. I'm a huge fan of that. The team management stuff, that's more of a head coach's stuff. It's not really what I play the game for, so it doesn't affect me, but it's still a nice touch. The news reports are good. The extra challenges, again, not really my sort of thing, but great for players who enjoy that sort of thing. Importing the FHM 5 save, that could be big for people. I don't really have one to bring through, so, you know, that's it's a shame, really, but, hey, if we can import from 6 to 7, I'm sure I'll have one ready to go for that. The fan stuff, making the fans matter and have an impact on the fans' happiness being a factor in how well your team plays, how settled your players are, and how much job security you have. That's realistic. And any movement towards a bit of realism, again, is a step in the right direction for me. And then the evolving rivalries. Similar to the player sort of abilities and personalities and all that sort of changing over time, the fact that the rivalries will evolve with you, if you go 20 years in the row, you know, down the stretch with someone, you're always playing them in the playoffs, like, you're always competing for a high draft pick, whatever it might be, whatever's going to set up that rivalry, I like the fact that that will be sort of taken into consideration within the game. So, again, a very nice sort of feature. Nothing too big, but they're all small improvements. And there wasn't too much, I thought, personally, that 5 needed to improve on. It was a good iteration of the game. I think it showcased the series pretty damn well. FHM 4 was solid. 3 had a few issues. They were still kind of learning. 1 felt rough, 2 felt like what we thought 1 would be, 3 felt like what we thought 2 would be. I think it caught up in FHM 4. So 5 was a step in the right direction, and 6 now is another step towards more world complexity, better stories, more immersion in a nutshell. And when I'm playing long term and I'm getting attached to my team, and the youngsters I'm drafting and seeing what they do in the world, to have that world matter is a big part of that. That will impact on my gameplay and my strategies and my enjoyment a lot. So I'm very happy with the fact that they've taken that into consideration. They've added international stuff. They've added more tournaments over the last couple of versions. They've brought in more online play and league play. That's great as well. None of that's really for me, but I really do appreciate the fact that it's in there and a large part of the user base does rate that sort of thing. But it looks and feels a lot like the game we know. But there's an extra layer. There's more information. There's more features. It's an evolving world, and it's definitely a step in the right direction. So we'll see how it works out year after year, how the drafts sort of compare to past years, how the trading system compares, any improvements to the match engine, see how they work out and so forth. I haven't got round to that yet myself. We will do a follow-up, hopefully with a giveaway attached for this game. So keep an eye out for that if you've lasted this long. I haven't mentioned it until now because reward the people who stay until the very end. So that sort of stuff will come up in a follow-up video. And yes, this is long-winded, but I feel like there was a lot to talk about, just in case there's people that were new to the series. But we got the new stuff out of the way early on. So those that just wanted to know what was new and just get an idea of if they wanted to pick up the game or stick with their copy of FHM 5 and their save they got already going on, they could get that information. But for the newer folks, explain a bit more about the game and the way sort of I'd go about starting and my ideas for a team like this and what I'm looking for. Maybe just to help you get your feet sort of under the desk a little bit and into the game. There are good tutorials on YouTube, various channels, including the official channel as well, Out of the Park Developments. You can look them up on Twitter as well, and they have a Twitch channel where they do play Out of the Park Baseball and Franchise Hockey Manager. So you'll get a feel there and be able to ask the devs a little bit about that. And of course, my channel, we will be doing a series here with the Colorado Avalanche. That'll be starting up, I believe, next week or so. And from time to time, I will be taking that onto Twitch for a live stream or two. I do live stream Football Manager throughout the week. So I will be sprinkling in some FHM into that lineup as well, because really, I can't wait to play this. I cannot wait to play this. The Avalanche look good this year. We've got the updated rosters. I know what I would change in real life. I want to do it in the game and see how it all plays out. So, hey, that's going to wrap things up for me. But keep a ear out for the giveaway on Twitter at Chris Orme or this very channel for a follow-up video where it will be announced as well. I'll see you then. Y'all take care. Until then, and as we say, 10% off right now, $35.99 on Steam or on their website. Rewind to the beginning of the video for the actual link and all the details about the bundle. Slightly cheaper for a bundle on Steam. So you can go check that out. Out of the Park 20, FHM 6, both together for $41.38 in terms of US dollars. Regional equivalents apply as always. But it's here and it's time we get back on the ice.